so frank about what worked and what didn't work. I think this is how we learn in a business school, because even though you may not have failed yet, you know, we, us old guys, typically have, and we have an opportunity to do that.
On failure, just for a second, I don't know, there are very few people, you look at the most successful people in the world, I know very few of them that haven't had a major failure. You know, if you read through the, they're not the financially most successful people. If you read through the Forbes billionaire list and you read their stories, you know, they've had failed businesses and they've lost everything and they've hung on the, you know, they've almost died holding on to the ledge. You know, what's his name? The guy who owns CBS and Sumner Fire, Sumner Redstone.
Redstone. Yeah.
So there are lots of examples of people who had huge adversity. And I think it's how you deal with adversity that determines your ultimate success, as opposed to how you deal with success that determines your ultimate success. So that's one of the things I've learned.
Good lesson.
From JCPenney and otherwise.
Okay. So you're an investor, Bill, but you know, once you get on a board, you're also, you know, you're a board member inside Pershing Square, you are a kind of a manager and leader. So how do you describe your personal management style, your leadership style? Not necessarily as an investor, mm-hmm. but when you're actually leading things inside or around.
Okay, so the only leadership role I have in a public company today is I'm chairman of the board of a company called the Howard Hughes Corporation. And there I'm a non-executive chair, and I work, I have an outstanding CEO, a guy by the name of David Weinreb, who runs the company, and he's outstanding. The key things I did there were, one, I recruited him. Two, I gave him, we set up an incentive arrangement with him. He was the first guy I did one of these, you know, buy 7-year warrant, you can't sell for 6 years. He put up his own money. In his case, he invested $15 million, it's worth $150 million 3 years later. So in his case, it seems to have worked better than in the JCPenney case. Although I would say in the JCPenney case, it worked well too for a second, in that Ron did, he lost his $50 million. So he did, you know, the alignment was there. But that doesn't guarantee you an outcome. But key, you know, set up the incentive structure that so that the management issues are aligned with yours, and then just be direct. You know, my approach in business, in my personal life, in a management role, is extreme candor. And I think that if you live that way, you know, you'll run the risk of offending various people over time, but you'll have much better relationships because, you know, if you tell people the truth, first of all, it's not typical. You know, a lot of people, in the interest of politeness, or fear of confrontation, or it's just uncomfortable, don't speak the truth. And that goes for people on boards. Mm-hmm. You know, there are lots of examples of super talented people sitting around the room as an institution is failing. Think of all the banks during the crisis where people were not willing to confront the CEO. So I'm willing to confront the CEO, but I'm completely candid with him about his successes and his failures. But I give him, you know, I don't step on his, I don't run the company, I'm not involved day-to-day at all, I trust his judgment. It's a bit of a trust but verify type relationship, and it's worked very well. So that's the my only public leadership role. I am CEO of Pershing Square. It's a much easier business to run than a normal company because we've got only 56 employees. And here the key is, the key to successful leadership is, one, hiring the right people. I have the benefit of not inheriting anyone because I hired everyone in the company. I interview every receptionist, I interview every secretary, I interview every investment person. And so I get to pick ultimately everyone that I work with, and that helps leadership a lot. Because if you hire, the key behind leadership, if you hire super talented people, you don't need to do that much leadership because they're going to do the right thing. Second thing is setting up the incentives correctly. So in Pershing Square, everyone is incentivized by how the overall firm does, which I think is a good dynamic because it creates teamwork. I follow the same extreme candor approach in evaluating people. And I care about everyone I work with as I do of family members. And so we look out for each other. And if someone's going through a difficult health issue or personal issue, financial issue, or you know, I have the benefit of having a lot of relationships, and whether it's the medical community or in the business community or in the political community, and so we help our people, and we don't tolerate insincerity. People are encouraged to admit their mistakes immediately before they figure out a solution to the problem. So when I hired my CFO, in the first year of working with him, he would approach me with a mistake he had made after he had figured out how to solve the problem. And I would get angry with him every time. I said, no, I don't want to hear about the mistake after you figured out the solution. I want to hear the mistake now, and then we can work together on solving the problem. So I think if you have an organization where people very quickly admit mistakes, and where you're candid with them, and they're not punished for making a mistake, that is a very good dynamic. And it's worked very well. We have almost no turnover, even in the reception desk at Pershing Square. And that's worked, it's been a good model. Great. And so I don't do that much leadership other than, I guess on the leadership side, I think you have to, you have to set an example in terms of the way you live, in terms of the way you behave, because that affects how other people will watch you. So my other key success factor for being a leader in the 21st century, in the era of everyone having a video camera on their cell phone, is assume that everything you're doing is being videoed and recorded at all times, and that will, and consider that the video ends up as a top video on YouTube, and then adjust your behavior accordingly.
So. Fair.